We're visiting with Jean Meyer, and Jean is one of the volunteers here at the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse. She's going to share with us a little bit of the history of the keeper's quarters and also the relocation of the quarters, which have just reopened.
Okay, Ken, right on this side you have your double keeper's quarters, which is where the two assistant keepers lived with their families, and the smaller building is the principal keeper's quarters, and this is where the lead keeper lived with his family. This was built in 1853. This one was built in 1870 out of bricks that were left over from the lighthouse. The frame addition on the far side was added in the 1900s, but it was originally the brick, and it was called the Pink House because it was pink brick. I have no idea when it was painted. This building was moved along with the lighthouse, but it started in February of 1999. You can't see the extension over there from this view, but the whole thing was picked up and moved from the original site down to here. There were three bulldozers, a flatbed truck, and men with huge wheels underneath the house were on ropes so that they could turn them. And then there was what I called the concert master out walking along and making sure that everything was working. It scared me. It scared me when they pulled that out. There was a lot of creaking going on, and the only thing they had braced on that house were the chimneys. The principal keeper's quarters went in March. That was, and actually they had quite a time getting that up because there were different points of gravity for that house, so they had a little bit of difficulty, and also they had no substantive plans that they could work from. But they got them down here in February and March, and the lighthouse itself came down in June and July.
Now there's still some work going on the outside, but I understand the inside is ready for visitors.
Yes, it is. On both buildings, they were opened Easter weekend. And while we're walking, let me tell you what I always consider to be a rather interesting story about the double keeper's quarters. At one time, there were 17 children living in this building, 9 on one side and 8 on the other.
My gosh. Did they help carry things to the top of the light?
I would imagine so. It was probably, you know, if you'll help, we'll give you a nickel and go in Buxton and spend it.
Now, we were told while visiting the Ocracoke light by the ranger there that one of the keepers also had a lot of children to help carry the oil up to the top of the light.
I would imagine that they did get pressed into service quite a bit. And this is a portion of the original Fresnel lens that was at the top of the lighthouse. Now this is a first order lens. The Fresnel lenses came in actually 7 sizes, but they were numbered 1 through 6. And your number one, your first orders, were for seacoast installations. And the as they went down in size, they were like in harbor lights. Unfortunately, this was vandalized at the time that the lighthouse was abandoned in the 30s. And some of the Park Service has other portions of it stored away. There have been stories that there is a piece of it out in San Francisco. Don't know how true that is, but this is what we have left.
Now the lens magnified the light so ships could see it at sea.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yep. And this was actually 6 feet across when it was intact. Of course, the main reason for the lighthouse being here was because this is on the edge of the Diamond Shoals, which are infamous and known as the graveyard of the Atlantic. And this exhibit points out some of the methods that were used to rescue people at sea over the years. This was one of your original surf boats with the crews from the lifesaving station would go out and bring in the people. Here's the Diamond Shoals light ship, which was out on the at the point of the graveyard at the Atlantic, but they couldn't keep the ship out there. Mm-hmm. It kept landing on the beach with all the storms, so now it's a Texas tower that is out there. And it's approximately 13 miles out. We used to be able to see it from Avon at night, but it's gotten the dunes have gotten so high we can't see it anymore. Of course, this is today with the Coast Guard and their Jayhawk, which flies just about every day back and forth patrolling the beach. Coast Guard during the war on horseback, which is a great way to get around here. And of course, there were many, many, many ships that were torpedoed and sunk. The old timers will tell you that they used to be able to see the fires burning offshore at night. And of course, this is a modern day Coast Guard cutter. This is an exhibit of some of the materials that they carried with them as they were patrolling the beach. And this is a watchman's token. And as the surfman got to the end of his route or his tour, he passed it off to the next surfman. So this was an indication that they had completed their tour. Of course, since families lived here and there was no modern conveniences such as heating facilities, this was a fireplace that was used for heating, possibly even cooking. They might have used it for cooking, but these buildings are so beautiful. Here we have the other fireplace for the second half of the duplex. This was a duplex with two families living in it up. They had up and down. Take note of the knotty pine. This is original. Here we have a ship's compass in brass. Over here, a clock and a ship's bell. This exhibit pertains to the graveyard of the Atlantic, which we mentioned before. And there are items here that were washed up after ships were sunk. This was from the USS Huron. This was a porthole from a ship that was sunk by a U-boat. And here you have the monitor, which was the ironclad that was sunk in a storm off Hatteras.
Why do you have sea oats in the keeper's quarters?
This is for our visitors to see. Sea oats are very, very important for keeping the sand in place and preserving our dunes. And it is against the law to pick them, so this is why we point it out.
I see.
And this room is dedicated to the role that Hatteras Island and the Outer Banks played during the various wars. This exhibit is for the Civil War. This is World War II, showing some of the artifacts from the German submarines that were so active sinking shipping off our coast. This is a depiction of the 1803 lighthouse, which was damaged during the Civil War. And after the war, Congress decided that we had to have a lighthouse here. So this was torn down after the present lighthouse was built in 1870.
This room appears to have more of the history of life on the Outer Banks and Cape Hatteras. I certainly recognize that. That's one of R.A. Fessenden's towers.
Tell me about it.
Yes. Well, as I read, he conducted some of the first experiments with voice from Hatteras Island to Roanoke Island, and in fact, broadcast the first musical notes over radio from here. Billy Mitchell.
I know a little bit about Billy Mitchell. He proved that you could sink submarines from an airplane. I take it this is a picture of him blowing one up.
Right, off of Hatteras Island. Mm-hmm. And of course, the Wright brothers.
Of course, the Wright brothers.
More of these exhibits seem to deal with life the way it used to be on the Outer Banks. There's a windmill, sailboats and not powered boats, boat building, fishing, and driving in the sand before
driving
there were highways.
In the sand.
Look at how they've taken the small pieces of wood and made a two-lane road just wide enough for a car.
Amazing. I understand that they didn't have roads on Hatteras till 1947.
And this is the principal keeper's quarters?
Yes, this is where the head lightkeeper lived with his family. It was originally called the Pink House, as I told you before, because it was made out of the bricks left over from the lighthouse. At one time, This was when we first moved here. This was used as a VIP house for visiting dignitaries from the government. And here we are in the principal keeper's quarters, which is now being used as a bookstore displaying items of interest about the lighthouse and about Hatteras Island.
Now, where does the money go that's raised from the sale of the books and the other items about the island and the lighthouse?
The bookstore is run by Eastern National, which is a nonprofit organization, and the money is returned to the park. This was the original kitchen, and it is part of the frame addition that was added to the house in the 1900s.
And now this is where you can find the books and prints and tapes for sale.
Yes, yes.
Quite a collection of tapes too, many of which I have seen on television. And this calendar I'm quite familiar with, the relocation calendar, with beautiful pictures of the move of the Hatteras Lighthouse.
That was an exciting time.
Oh, fantastic.
Park Service volunteer Shafe Schaefer took us on a tour of the lighthouse from the bottom all the way to the top.
How many people visit the lighthouse in the summertime?
Last summer we had 220,000. The record day last year was a little over 3,400. Yeah, it's a pretty busy time in the summer. During the move we averaged 17,000 people a day. Rather busy, and our responsibilities as volunteers was to explain the move, why they moved it, and some of the technical aspects of it, plus who did the move. During the move, even though it was ahead of schedule, there was absolutely no damage to any of the buildings. And I'm not sure there is such a thing as perfection, Ken, but this is about as close as you can get. Good public relations, ahead of schedule, safe, and no damage. And that's a pretty good combination for a contract.
Now, how many steps did you say there were?
We can climb 257 steps.
How many have I climbed so far? I got a ways to go.
About 50.
What are the tiles made of at each of the landings?
Those are marble tiles. And the base downstairs is granite, and approximately 1.25 million bricks constitute the lighthouse, plus the cast iron and steel up at the balcony.
Now you said that one day you had over 3,000 visitors. How many people are allowed in the lighthouse at one time?
Well, usually the rule of thumb was 30 on the balcony and 75 climbing or descending. But when you get 3,400, you have over 600 an hour. And that's really pushing people up and down. And at that time, I'm sure we had more in the balcony and more than in the lighthouse. Okay, Ken, we're nearing the last landing. The next stop will be the balcony. This is as far as we allow the public to go in the summer. During the summer, we'll have 36 volunteers on call. To man it, we'll have two people on top, one on the bottom, so three per shift. The season opens Good Friday and lasts until Columbus Day, the middle of October.
This obviously turns the light.
This turned the Fresnel lens. Now it does not work because we have the electric lights where it was electrified in 1934. But until that time, yes, this was the mechanism that did all the work. Body Island, by the way, still has the Fresnel lens. We've been looking for one down here, but they're very scarce and very expensive.
This lens is different than the one in Body Island and Kerala Light.
Right. The Body Island has a Fresnel lens. This has been replaced with spotlights with a 1,000-watt bulb. The beacon turns one complete rotation every 15 seconds, but you'll see a flash every 7.5 seconds. In 1879, Congress designated that all lighthouses would be painted a different color as you can see along the coast, and each would have a different light signal. So the ships would know where they were, either during the day or at night.
Next, it was time to take a look outside.
Well, we've climbed the 257 steps. Let's now go out into the balcony.
And once again, the view from the top of the lighthouse was nothing less than spectacular.
Thank you so much for being with us. I hope you'll join us again next week for more people, places, and things from the Outer Banks in northeastern North Carolina. May God bless you richly.
Sometimes I dream of just sailing out from Nag's Head. Maybe spend the day just fishing with my friends. And I wonder if that girl